And we welcome you to another Friar Legends First Ever Jersey Retirement Celebration here for Providence College. What a great tradition that this is. And to do it on a day after such a game that we had at the Dunkin' Donuts Center this afternoon, that's what it means to be a Friar. Never give up on anything, right? Tremendous day to be a Friar. Athletic Director Bob Driscoll always says it's a great day to be a Friar. It's always a great day to be a Friar. Providence College community is extremely excited to celebrate and retire the jerseys of six of the greatest players of all time to wear the black and white. Former basketball standouts, the late Bruce Soup Campbell, class of 78, Otis Thorpe, class of 84, Doris Burke, class of 87. In addition, we're also excited to honor our first group of Friar hockey standouts, Lou Lamarillo, class of 63, Ron Wilson, class of 77, and Cammy Granato, class of 93. The Friar Legends Forever tradition began in 1996. To earn this honor, the player or coach must have made a significant impact on Friar athletics, and he or she must have received national recognition during their career while at Providence. Tonight's honorees will join Tracy Liss, Kevin Stakem, Joe Hassett, Marvin Barnes, Helen Burt, Ernie DiGregorio, Dave Gavitt, Kathy Finn Hill, Joe Mullaney, John Egan, Vinny Ernst, Ray Flynn, Jimmy Walker, Lenny Wilkins, Andrea Mangum, John Thompson, and Jim Hadnott. Now that is some kind of group. It never ceases to amaze me that the little college up on Smith Hill, under 4,000 undergrads, turns out the quality of athlete that they have, not only through the days and the years, but through the decades. That's amazing. And everybody who's a Friar is to be congratulated for that. So let's start by introducing our honorees here tonight. Ron Wilson grew up in Riverside, Rhode Island. Was an All-American selection twice and a four-time All-ECAC selection. As a sophomore, he was named ECAC Player of the Year when he led the nation with 26 goals, 61 assists in only 26 games. Wilson is a member of the Providence Athletic Hall of Fame. He still holds school records and NCAA records, by the way, for a defenseman, in career points, assists, most points in a single season, and single season assists. He coached in more than 1,400 NHL games and has 648 wins to his credit. He spent 18 seasons as a head coach in the NHL with Toronto, San Jose, Washington, and Anaheim. On the international side, Wilson has been Team USA's head coach for some of its biggest, best, brightest moments in history, including leading Team USA to a silver medal at the 2010 Olympic Winter Games and to the championship in the inaugural World Cup of Hockey in 1996. Wilson has also directed the U.S. men's national team that captured the bronze at the 1996 IIHF Men's World Championship in Vienna, Austria. In 2016, Wilson coached the Team USA World Junior squad to a bronze medal at the 2016 IIHF World Junior Championships. How about that resume? Representing Ron tonight, please give a warm welcome to his brother Brad Wilson, class of 1978. Next up is Soup Campbell. Campbell grew up in New Haven, Connecticut. He was one of the most mobile forwards to ever play for the Friars. In four seasons at Providence, he registered 1,809 points, averaging almost 15 points per game for his career, 949 rebounds. He ranks ninth all-time in scoring for the Friars, eighth all-time in rebounding. In four seasons, Campbell helped the team to an 89-35 record, which is almost 72% wins. During his time at Providence, the team made two NITs and two NCAA appearances. As a senior, he led the team in scoring at almost 18 points per game. He helped the Friars post a 24-8 mark and advance to the 78 NCAA tournament. For his efforts, Soup was named a UPI Honorable Mention All-American in 1978. He was drafted in the eighth round of the 1978 NBA draft by the New Jersey Nets. Representing Soup here tonight, please give a warm welcome to Soup's former teammate, John Nolan, class of 80, and his son, Justin Campbell, and Bill Eason, class of 78. It just came to my attention a little while ago, though, but I think his son, Justin. Justin, did you hit the game winner for Rhode Island College today? Had a baby. Love it. Next up is Cammie Granato. Cammie's a native of Downers Grove, Illinois. She was the most dominant of women's hockey players to play for the Friars. Shoot, forget the Friars. How about in the planet? She still holds the all-time career points and goal-scoring records at PC. While at Providence, Granato was named ECAC Player of the Year for three consecutive seasons. She was a four-time ECAC All-Star Team selection. She finished her career as a Friar with 256 points, 139 goals, 117 assists. Granato holds the top two spots in the single-season points leader. She scored 84 points in 92-93, and 80 again in 91 and 92. She's also the single season leader in goals with 48 and assists with 43. During her time in Providence, Granato led the team to two ECAC championships. Since graduating from Providence, Granato has gone on to captain the U.S. team in the 1998 and the 2002 Olympic Games, winning gold and silver medals respectively. She's been inducted into the Providence Athletics Hall of Fame. She was the first woman to be inducted into the USA Hockey Hall of Fame and the Hockey Hall of Fame. Please welcome Cammie Granato. Coach Lehman, do you think maybe we could find a couple of shifts for her somewhere? I think probably so, right? Next up, Otis Thorpe. Thorpe is a native of Boynton Beach, Florida. Played in 113 games, which ranks third all-time at Providence, and career field goal percentage also at 575. Imagine that. Almost hit 60% of his shots for his entire career. He's a two-time Associated Press Honorable Mention All-American. Thorpe was the Friars' very first All-Big East honoree. He got third-team accolades in 82 and 83 and earned first-team All-Big East in 84. As a freshman, Thorpe was named to the 81 Big East All-Rookie Team. He was the ninth selection of the 1984 NBA draft by the Kansas City Kings. He played in 1,257 games for nine different teams in the NBA, more games than any other Friar has managed in NBA history. During that time, he averaged 14 points and 8.2 rebounds per game for those 14 years. Thorpe helped the Houston Rockets capture the NBA title while he was there as well. Friar fans, please welcome home Otis Thorpe. I can admit, just announcing these names up here is kind of giving me chills up here. This is pretty cool. All right, next up is Lou Lamorello, and Lou has done just about everything since coming to the college as a student way back in 1959. You know, as a player, he played both hockey and baseball. You could do that back then. He ranks 33rd on the Friars' all-time scoring list with 58 goals, 60 assists, 118 points in 64 career games. In his 15 seasons as a head coach of the Friars, well, the Providence native racked up 248 wins. He saw 11 of his 15 teams qualify for postseason play, including the NCAA tournament in 78, 81, and again in 83. Lamoriello's final team, the 82-83 squad, was one of the greatest in PC history. They went 33-10-0, finished third in the NCAAs. After that season, he stepped down to take over as athletic director on a full-time basis. And after assuming that role in July of 1982, he went on to become the absolute positive driving force in the creation of Hockey East. He served as the league's first director from 1984 to 1987. In June of 87, Lou stepped down as PC's director of athletics and Hockey East director to become the president and general manager of the New Jersey Devils of the National Hockey League. He has led them to three Stanley Cup titles. Lamoriello was also inducted into the Hockey Hall of Fame in 2009 in Toronto and was inducted into the U.S. Hockey Hall of Fame in 2012. Currently, he serves as the general manager for the Toronto Maple Leafs. Well, representing Lou here tonight, please give a warm welcome to his son, Chris Lamoriello. Well, last and certainly not least, let's welcome back Doris Burke Sable. Doris Sable Burke, whichever you prefer, but she was known as Doris Sable while she was on campus. She was a member of the women's basketball team from 1983 to 1987. Manasquan, New Jersey is her home where she was born, and she led the Friars in assists during three of her four programs, season program, and finished her career with 602 assists. Burke is ranked second all-time at Providence in career assists. She ranks 10th all-time in career scoring with better than 1,300, almost 1,400 points. Burke was a three-time All-Big East selection, including a member of the first team All-Big East as a senior. She was honored as a Kodak District 1 All-American that same season. Burke has since been inducted into the Providence College Athletics Hall of Fame and was also a recipient of the prestigious NCAA Silver Anniversary Award in 2012. Now, professionally, you all know who Doris is. Burke is widely known as one of the true pioneers in the world of television sports broadcasting. She's a versatile commentator who works a variety of ESPN assignments, including the NBA, men's college basketball, women's college basketball, the NCAA, and to think she got her start with us right here on the radio here in Providence. In addition to other assignments for other ESPN properties, she also serves as a sideline reporter for NBA playoff games and for the ESPN ABC NBA Finals. In September of 2016, it was announced that Burke will significantly expand her NBA game analyst role starting with this year. So it's already underway. Get on the train because Doris is leading the way. Please welcome home Doris Burke. Really cool to be a part of this tonight. I'm sure everybody's in agreement with that. Unfortunately, our athletic director, Bob Driscoll, is homesick with the flu. So here to speak tonight on his behalf, please welcome up Senior Associate Athletic Director, Steve Napolillo, Class of 98.
Thank you, David. Appreciate that. What a night. Can we give a huge round of applause for John Rook, one of the best in the business, what he does. Him and his partner, Joe Hassett, true gifts to Providence College. John, you're unbelievable. We thank you so much. As John said, my boss, one of the greatest men I truly love, is deathly ill at home, and we're wishing him a recovery. I just, This way I hope he gets a lot of texts from people in here in this room so he knows how much we love him. But Coach Cooley has personally said if I do a terrible job, he'll personally refund everyone's money tonight. So please send him emails based on how this goes. But tonight's just an unbelievable night after today. Tonight's a night to really celebrate success, celebrate family, and celebrate Friar Town. The names that we're going to honor tonight, I would say every college in the country would be blessed to say they wish they could have a class like this. And the names they're going to join, I'm going to ask, we're blessed to have Friar legends in the crowd tonight. Can I have Ernie D., Joe Hassett, Kathy Finn Hill, please stand. Their names hang in the dunk and Alumni Hall, proud for all of us. One of the great architects in Providence College Athletics, Dave Gavitt, obviously is here in spirit, but we're blessed to have his beautiful and loving wife, Julie Gavitt, here. So Julie, please stand. Thank you so much for being here tonight for all of us. Dave and Julie always put a smile on what they've done for Providence College. Their legacy will live forever. I want to thank all the sponsors that really helped make tonight possible. I loved calling each one and told them how lucky they were to be able to sponsor a VIP table at the event tonight. And each said, do I have a choice? I said, no, thank you for your support. So to each of you, I thank you very much for letting us put on first-class events. Please look at your donor books and programs because all these people help make Friar Town great. Let's give them all a huge round of applause. Thank you so much. I also want to thank my great team. There's so many people who work hard behind the scenes who aren't able to get acknowledged, and these things take so much time and effort, but I want to specifically thank Harold Starks and Jen Cunningham, who every day I'm blessed to have on my team. So Harold and Jen, thank you for all you do. Each honoree tonight has a special story. A story that brings great pride to all of us in Friar Town. Ron Wilson, arguably the greatest player ever to put on the skates in PC men's ice hockey. While he's recovering home, we're so blessed to have his brothers, his beautiful daughters, his grandchildren here to represent him. Thank you so much for being here. We know Ron's in spirit. Let's give the Wilsons a huge round of applause. Soup Campbell, I think this one's really tough for me. I got to know Soup really well, and his friends, his son, the people who are here today. Soup is smiling like no one has ever smiled up above us tonight because he loved Providence College more than anyone. He loved being part of the Friar families, and forget the basketball. He loved his friends, his teammates, and everybody he could see as he wore his Providence College sweatshirt every day. I used to tell him he should have my job at the dunk. He shook more hands than anyone at the Dunkin' Donuts Center. Let's give a huge round of applause for Soup Campbell. Cammy Granato. You know, anyone who's compared to Wayne Gretzky is big time. And I think with Cammy is you look at someone who's an inspiration for so many young boys, so many young girls. You look at somebody who's on her own Wheaties box. You look at somebody, you know, I had the honor with Coach DeRaney, Bob Belmore, and Bill Leary to go up to the Hall of Fame when she was inducted in Toronto. And Cammy, the greatest thing for me is I have someone who's given over $1 million to the women's ice hockey program at Providence. And Bill Leary was smiling so bright that night because a Friar women's ice hockey player was at the pinnacle that no one else could be. And thank you for just inspiring everybody, doing it humbly, and making us all proud and inspiration for everyone, young and old. Thank you so much, Cammy. Otis Thorpe, Coach Cooley, I was in his office yesterday. He was unbelievable. Coach said, if he can recruit 3 Otis Thorpes, we're gonna win a national championship. 17 years in the NBA, the average career in the NBA is 3 years. And Otis has done it being humble, being a good student, being a great family man, and just being a great Friar. Congratulations, Otis, to you and your family. Coach Lamoriello, I had the pleasure to meet Coach last night. It was a great night at Schneider. And it's great that his son Chris, his wife Vicky, their kids are here to celebrate this. Coach was unbelievable last night. You know, he's the godfather of Providence hockey. He built the foundation. He's so well known in NHL circles of what he's accomplished. And he said the nicest thing that for Coach Lehman, I think when we were interviewing him, he said, I'm so proud that the program that my players, my former teammates, my son, his wife, can be associated with, are national champions, and that we have an unbelievable coach for like Coach Lehman. So congratulations to the Lamoriello family, and it's great to have them all here tonight. Thank you. Lastly, Doris Burke. I think this is really special for me as my friendship with Doris, but talking to Coach Cooley, talking to Lou Schweckheimer, and Holly Rowe from ESPN, I got to talk on the phone the other night, who's in the crowd tonight. Holly, can I have you stand, Holly? Holly Rowe from ESPN, who's really close to Doris. I think we all know Holly's battle, inspiration. Tonight, Holly, you become a part of the ESPN family, but, you know, she was on the phone with me just saying, Doris Burke loves Providence College. I have to be there. Every time I'm with her, she's talking about PC, talking about how much she loves it, her teammates. Doris, you're an inspiration for all of us, because if it's late night madness, if it's helping a player out, if it's just talking about PC, you're the best there is. You're the best in your profession, no matter men, women, whatever. You're an inspiration. She told me on the phone, I'm embarrassed to do this tonight. Doris, every time we turn on the TV and watch you at an NBA game, college, Friar Town is pride, and we all smile. So Doris, congratulations. And lastly, the gentleman I get to introduce exemplifies all the qualities that our honorees have tonight. 12 years ago, he took the torch as the leader of this college, and it was a small Catholic liberal arts college, regional. Today, it's a premier national Catholic liberal arts college. And many years down the road, this man will have his name hanging somewhere with his robe. It's my honor to introduce our president, Brian Giancelli.
One question that I get sometimes at basketball games is, do I pray during the game? And I do, for various things. I don't pray for a win unless I think there's a really good reason to pray for a win. It's like, don't miss this foul shot, you know, this sort of thing. But today I decided I was going to ask God for a win, because I thought this dinner is going to be a disaster if we don't win this game today. Lord God, please, we have to win this game. So I don't want to take credit for the win. I'll give it to Coach Cooley. But I thank God that we won this game today. You know, when you see the dunk like it was this afternoon, it was roaring. And there were students there. We had prospective students there. We had parents of prospective students, we had alumni, we had a national television audience, and it's moments like this that you realize the power of athletics to build community. And today, we built the Friar family even stronger as a result of the experiences that we had today. And I want to give Coach Cooley credit. We did a little pep rally for prospective students before the game. And Coach Cooley came over. This is an hour before arguably the biggest game of the year for us. And Ed realized it would help the college to recruit students if he came over and spoke. And he came over, and as always, he did a great job. And Raul and I, Raul Fons, our admissions director, Mike Krzyzewski doesn't do stuff like that. I don't know any other college coach of a big-time program that an hour before an important game would say, I'm going to come over and give this for the future of Providence College. So, Ed, I want to thank you publicly for what you did today. You know, one of the things that I think as I sit here today, and, you know, people ask me if you like your job, and it depends on when you ask me. Tonight, I love my job. I get to be the president of a college that produces student athletes and graduates like the people up here. And we're less than 4,000 undergraduates. And as Stevie mentioned, we produced an all-star roster of student athletes. But more importantly, and this is for me the crux of why I care about athletics at Providence College, I like to win, I like the branding piece, I like the marketing, I like everything that college athletics gives to Providence College. But first and fundamentally, the only purpose of athletics on a college campus has to be educational. I have to believe, to invest the way that we have, that playing a sport at Providence College is going to make our young men and women better human beings. That they're going to learn things about themselves, about the world, about life, about teamwork, about discipline, all the things that we believe that athletic teaches. And that they're going to be better for that. And what we celebrate tonight, all these accomplishments on the athletic field, let's not lose sight of the lives that these people have led. We are honoring really good people tonight who have made a difference in the world for the better, who have taken their educational experiences and their athletic experiences and have given back. And that's, for me as a priest, the most important thing, is that athletics at Providence College has produced people who live really rich, meaningful, generous lives and have given back from what they've received when they were student athletes. And so we thank God for this. I thank God for this, and I'm extremely proud tonight to be the president of a college that has produced the people that we're celebrating tonight and all of you who have been a part of their lives. Now, this is my segue into grace, because that's my job too. I noticed that many of you have already started eating, but that's not a problem, because God can get even into your stomachs. So I'll be brief and ask you to pray along with me. Bless us, O Lord, in these thy gifts, which we are about to receive from thy bounty, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Enjoy the evening. Thank you.
Okay, let's do dinner. We'll get the program started here in about 20, 25 minutes. Thank you, everybody.
I met Ron because his dad, Larry, was a coach with the Rhode Island Reds, and they were playing at East Providence High School, and Ron was certainly one of the best.
Every high school hockey coach in Rhode Island was trying to get them to move into their community, because if you got Ron Wilson, you got Bradley Wilson, and you got Randy Wilson, so it was a three-foot package.
My father used to build a hockey rink in the back. It looked big at the time, but when you think about it, how small it really was, and all three of us played together, and because Ron was a little bit bigger than Randy and I, he always stuck one of us in the net.
His dad had players practice with me when they were injured, so he had an understanding of what the program was all about, and Ron had the potential of being a pro someday, and I think that I had the in roots of his dad in support of that, and Ron could have gone anywhere in the country.
Lou was upfront, honest, and said, I'm not going to bother you, we want you, and sold him on who he was, the program he was going to try to build, the fact that Snyder Arena was being built, and it was an opportunity for Ron to help build a program.
I remember seeing him in class, and he's a little guy, and he's wire-rimmed glasses, and he scored 100 points in Rhode Island High School hockey, and I'm like, Rhode Island High School hockey, big deal. We'll see how you do against boys from Minnesota and Canada. And the very first scrimmage, it was clear who the best player on the team was. Even as a freshman, Ronnie was a star right away.
He was just in a different dimension in terms of how he played the game. The thing that stands out, I remember when I first, a few practices, was His passing was just unbelievable.
He played like Bobby Orr, and he saw the ice like Wayne Gretzky. And playing with him was like playing with two center icemen. And that's how he was changing college hockey. An offensive defenseman that could make plays.
His skill was his ability to control and command the game. Did he have the hardest shot? No. Was he the fastest skater? Absolutely not. But he could read and react to plays. He could foresee what was happening. And he knew how to utilize his teammates. My freshman year, and we were playing in Dartmouth, and I think Ron was setting a record for most points by a defenseman, and he had 8 points in one game. It could have been 10 or 12. To score 8 points in a game on the road in a hostile environment, that's impressive. He did that while coaches were game planning against you.
When we needed a big goal or we needed something to happen in the game, everyone knew the drill. Just get Ronnie the puck. Get Wilson. We all called him Wilson. Get Wilson the puck. Something good's going to happen. And this guy could turn games around by himself, change games by himself, win games by himself. He was the best college hockey player in his era. And I would argue, even to this day, probably the greatest college hockey defenseman that ever played.
Coach was the architect, and Ron and the Wilson brothers were really, I think, the driving force.
Brad was a center, Randy was a left winger, and Randy scored 30 goals his freshman year. And Bradley, I don't think he ever lost a faceoff.
One of them would score a goal, and it was always Wilson from Wilson and Wilson.
It's hard to explain his impact on the ECAC back in the day. Our sophomore year, he had 87 points. And we didn't play 40 games like they do now. We played 28 games, I think, that year. He had 87 points.
He was so confident in his abilities to be able to carry the play, to make plays happen. You know, when you score 250 points, you have to have confidence, and he did.
I think what Lou wanted to do was build a national program, and Ron was what I would call his first superstar. They put Providence on a hockey map, and we've seen what's happened here since that point.
Hello, I'm Nate Lehman with the Men's Ice Hockey Program. First, I'd like to congratulate all the inductees tonight on this tremendous honor. About 2 months into me taking the position here at Providence College, we had an alumni golf outing. And at the golf outing, I was approached by two or three people right off the bat that mentioned having this night happen for Ron Wilson. He was the best defenseman ever to play at Providence College and maybe in all of college hockey, period. It's unfortunate that Ron can't be here tonight, but we're so happy to have this night take place on behalf of one of the best players ever to play college hockey, Ron Wilson.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to stage Friar Men's head hockey coach, Nate Lehman. And for Ron Wilson, his brother Brad, class of 78.
Of the Wilson family, I'll just start off quickly. The Wilson family, the reason I'm up here representing Ron is because I'm the shortest of the three of us who played here. First of all, unfortunately, due to health reasons, obviously Ron and certainly his wife Maureen couldn't attend. I know he'd look forward to this for a long time, and I'm sure he's got all the well wishes from everybody that's here, and he will continue to move forward in his endeavor to be the person that we all know. Father Shanley, Athletic Director Bob Driscoll, I know you're sick. Harold Starks, Jen Cunningham, and Steve Napolillo, Dominican fathers, Providence College athletic family and supporters, friends, family, obviously Ron's daughters, and if they would stand up, Kristen and Lauren. Ron's son-in-law, Jonathan, And obviously the most important two people that are here for him is his granddaughters, Riley and Kingsley. On behalf of the Wilson family and certainly Ron, I'm both honored and humbled to be represented, Ron, at such a prestigious and what I would call a long overdue honor for him. I know that Ron would first like to extend his heartfelt congratulations to Doris Burke, Otis Thorpe, the late Bruce Soup Campbell, who actually was a classmate of mine in 1978, arguably the greatest woman hockey player ever, Cami Granato, and probably the most influential person in at least the Wilson family lives, Lou Lamoriello, and I know, Chris, you can pass that along to your dad, in their inductions into the Friar Legends forever. I strongly believe that Providence College hockey is where it is today because of two people, Ron Wilson and Lou Lamoriello. Lou and Ron have always represented Providence College with attributes both passed along by the Dominican family. Be humble, be respectful, provide ethical and moral leadership, and maintain your dignity and humility. Ron came to Providence College because of Lou Lamoriello. Ron was always the best player at every level on every team that he ever played on. And great athletes such as Ron earned their statue. It's not given to them. It is hard to maintain that level of competitiveness each and every game. And they both believed in what Lou always preached. You play for the name on the front of your jersey, not the one that's on the back. His statistics alone distinguish him, Ron, as not only the greatest hockey Friar in PC history, although I'm biased, I would certainly argue that Ron could be one of the top one, two, or three athletes in the history of Providence College Athletics. He holds NCAA records for most points ever by a defenseman, most assists in NCAA history. His 250 points at the time that he left PC was a mere 80 points greater than that who was number two at the time. And he did that as a defenseman, and number two was a forward. Since I'm up here, I'm gonna pat myself on the back for a minute. My freshman year, I thought I had a great year when I recorded a freshman record of 57 points in 26 games playing forward, ranking number two behind Ron, who led the entire nation with 87 points. That's 50% more than the second person on the team. And I've never seen that at any level in pro hockey at all by a defenseman. Phenomenal statistic. I compare Ron to kind of another sport, kind of outside the box. And I've always said Ron was a thoroughbred and the rest of us were quarter horses. He was at Churchill Downs and we're at Narragansett Racetrack. We're in two different places. Ron was a much better person than he was a player. And I'm gonna give you an example, and sorry for me, because I was involved. In 1976, Ron had been chosen to play for the United States Olympic hockey team. And during the preseason playing of the Olympic team that they went around before they went over to the Olympics, Ron was again their leading scorer in the Olympic team, and Ron's current wife, his girlfriend at the time, Maureen, had not been feeling well. And Ron, as selfless as he was, decided that I'm coming home, I'll take care of her. He left the Olympic team to be with Maureen, and he helped her guide her back to health. And he gave of himself for Maureen. Now, Ron is going through some tough times health-wise, and God has blessed Ron with Maureen, who now is giving back to Ron. She is his support, she is his hope for full recovery, and his guiding light. Ron's successes professionally are certainly well documented. His 1996 World Cup of Hockey triumph over Canada still ranks today as the second greatest U.S. hockey achievement outside of the Miracle on Ice. He coached the 2010 silver medal winning U.S. Olympic hockey team, losing to Canada in overtime, a victory snatched away when his team hit the crossbar, also in overtime. His 648 NHL coaching victories speak for themselves. And I'll leave everyone with this. The great Jerry Rice once said, "I feel like I'm the best, but you will not get me to say that." And it sounds as if Ron would have said that. So let me say it. Ron, you're the very best hockey player ever to don a Friar jersey. You're Providence College hockey. And as your brother, I'm proud. So God bless and Godspeed in your recovery. And I love you.
Thank you, Brad. Congratulations to Class of 77, Ron Wilson. Next up, we introduce our video for Bruce Soup Campbell, 1978.
Big fight for the rebound, and Joe Hassett comes down with it. Feeds off to Campbell. You got that soft, soft shot.
I tell people Soup was like Lamar Odom. You know, can handle the rock, can shoot, pretty much played a point guard, pretty much played the two guard, can play the big man also.
He was a great passer, and he always saw the floor and his soft, feathery shot.
Quick as a cat, at 6'9", who could handle the ball like a point guard, and you didn't see that in those days. He was more like a point forward.
And he had that uncanny ability with that left-handed hook that nobody could stop.
When Soup was in high school, his team was the number one team in the country, so Soup was like one of the top recruits in all of America coming into PC.
He was a very social guy. He would have his breakfast in alumni, walk in, he'd place his order with the woman behind the counter, and I believe her name was Ann. And when the order was ready, she would just bellow out, "Soupy, your eggs are ready." We always joke with them all the time about that. And to this day, that stands out. And anybody that sat around, they know what I'm talking about.
Soup was always upbeat, always.
He had such a zest for life, he just gave that back to everybody.
He was definitely a legend. He was definitely a legend.
At Providence, you had a sense that they had just come off the Final Four and they were still really good. We were probably the last teams to be consistently ranked in the top 20 week in and week out. National TV against North Carolina, national TV against Louisville.
Dave had all to do with that. He was always on the NCAA committee. So by doing that, he developed relationships with a lot of different coaches, and that's how we got games in the Providence. Every Saturday, it seemed like we were on TV.
We didn't feel intimidated by it. Gavitt had this way, and Joey had this way of letting us believe that we could play with anybody. And of course, Soup Campbell felt the same way.
That was the mentality back then, because we were a top 15 team every year. It just, the mentality was, we're going to win this game. I don't care if these guys are number one. Sure enough, we proved it.
Defense is what kept us in that game. I mean, it was 82-81, but two over, I think regulation was only 68-68. And Gavitt had a way to make games against these great teams play in the 60s for us.
I remember him getting the North Carolina team in Green Airport, because it was a nationally televised game, and the atmosphere was simply electric. I may have shot the ball that, you know, hit the last 2 points, but the pass came from who else? Soup.
He was probably the best spokesman for Providence College. Anytime you saw Soup, it didn't matter what time of the year, he had a Providence basketball hat on, or a sweatshirt on, or a t-shirt on. It was always Providence, and this was his life.
spirit is still with us. And I love him, and I miss him.
I know, Soup, you're looking down on us. I'm hoping you're proud. This is your night. We miss you, buddy.
I have his pictures on my dresser. I talk to him every day, and you know, I have faith he's up there watching over all of us, especially his Friars, because he loved his Friars.
I came to Providence because I think the tradition was always there, and it was close-knit, and that's what I like in people. And when I came up here and I seen how close and together everybody was, it made me feel right at home. Just being here was my pleasure. I enjoyed it 100%. Providence is my family. School will always be a part of me, and I just love it.
Hi, I'm Dan Patrick, and just wanted to offer a few words about Bruce Soup Campbell. I was fortunate to meet Soup through John Nolan and spent quite a few afternoons with Soup. I've never seen somebody have the same personality every single day. No matter when you saw him, he always had that same smile on his face. And he remembered small things. He would always ask about your family. Now, I knew who Soup was growing up. We're similar age, and I was able to follow him. Knew he was one of the best players to ever play in Connecticut. Also went to the Nets. But he never talked about his career. He talked about family, talked about his family or your family, and I just remember the smile. We were very, very fortunate to have somebody who would have that smile and constantly was looking at saying something nice, being about something positive. And I think that's what I miss most about him, the person. Pretty special.
I want to congratulate all of our honorees. Soup Campbell, man. What a smile, shook every hand in the building, epitomizes what this Friar family is all about. His smile, his energy, his enthusiasm. Soup, God rest you. God rest your soul. Congratulations to you and your family, and we can't tell you how proud we are to have this bestowed on you today.
Please welcome to the stage Friar head coach Ed Cooley. And also John Nolan, class of 80, Bill Eason, class of 78, and Soup's son, Justin Campbell.
Hello, everybody. I want to start by thanking Harold Starks and Bob Driscoll and Steve Knapp for inviting me, to say a few words about my beloved friend Soup. But first, I'd like to congratulate the other honorees. What a great night to be a Friar. I could stand up here and talk hours about Soup's basketball accomplishments, which we know were many. His great high school career being a first-team All-American on the number one team in the country. The fact that he was a top recruit in the country and could have gone anywhere but chose PC. His career as a Friar, as a New Jersey Net, and his 9-year career in Europe. But instead, I prefer to talk about the man, the person I loved. New Haven was home for Soup, and he loved New Haven, but Providence was his second home. My time with Soup can be divided up between PC and post-PC. During school, he was my captain and never let me forget, ever. He took all the young guys under his wing and showed us a good time. I don't have to elaborate on that. We'll just leave it at that. Soup and I lost track for a number of years while he was playing overseas. But about 25 years ago, I moved back to Milford, Connecticut, which was only 15 minutes away from New Haven, and we picked up where we left off, and our families became very close. He was a great father to his 4 children and grew to be a favorite uncle to my own 3 children who loved him very much. He was always known as Uncle Soup. Everyone will agree he was a special human being. And like that old cliche, he would take the shirt off his back if you needed it. That pretty much sums up Soup to a T. To say he was a thoughtful individual would be an understatement. Soup was not only the kindest man I knew, he was the most considerate. The first to call if you were sick, the first to call on your birthday, the first to call on Father's Day, and even my wife Laurel on Mother's Day. There wasn't a special occasion he forgot. It was amazing, and I learned so much from him. We spent many weekends together at my house when the kids were young, but it was every 4th of July that we have our fondest memories of Soup, taking charge at the helm of the grill, and boy, did he love to grill. I miss those times more than I can say because he was always the life of the party. Soup was just a happy-go-lucky who just went through life with a smile that our good buddy Dan Patrick refers to in the video. We've all seen it, we all know it, and we'll never forget it. I never met a person that was loved as much as Soup. He had more friends than I can count. I called him the mayor because no matter where he went, it was always, and we all heard it before, Soup, Soup. No matter where he went, the Big East, it was always Soup. And as Billy Easton said, the guy was a legend. And the beauty was, you never knew he was one. He was also humble. He just thought he had a million friends. Even when we came up for the games at the Civic Center, I'm sorry, us old guys still can't call it the you-know-what, which were some of my best times with Soup, he was still like the superstar he was back in the 70s. And as Dominic and I, his other great friend, always talk about, once the ball went up at tip-off time, Soup was gone. He just made his rounds. He was out of his seat and gone for the rest of the game, but I always say, I'll see you at halftime. Just walking around, talking, and hugging everyone. He always made a special stop to see Coach Gavin, of course, and Brother Kevin, and Father Morris, who obviously was his favorite. He truly was a roving ambassador for the Friars because he loved Providence College so much. It was such a part of his life, just as he himself said in the video. I'll never forget Dennis Burke. I'll never forget what Dennis Burke said at Soup's funeral. Dennis was another great friend of Soup's. He said that Soup was colorblind, that he didn't see race. He only saw the person, and nothing could be more true. He didn't care if you were black or white. Soup viewed life through the lens of love, and that's why he got so much love in return. Let's face it, he was one of a kind. There will never be another Soup Campbell. At this time, I'd just like to introduce a couple of people sitting at my table. First, his pride and joy, you just met up on the stage here, his son, Justin Campbell. My family has known Justin since he was a little boy, and to this day, consider him part of our family. In fact, he and my son, Drew, are best buds. I guess apples really don't fall far from the tree. Justin is a sophomore at Rhode Island College, and like his old man, is having a great basketball career. Maybe, unlike his old man, he is a very fine student. And hope someday to be an architect. Justin, your dad would be so proud of you. Next to Justin are my two girls, Ryan and Kylie. Ryan's a class of PC 2012, and we do forgive her, but Kylie is a Fordham Ram class of 2015. Unfortunately, my wife, Laurel, and my son, Drew, couldn't be here tonight, but they are here in spirit to honor Soup. And just going around the table, we have one of his teammates here, Monty Douglas, on that great Wilbur Cross High School team. And also his favorite teacher, Mr. Romano. Mr. Romano, he always told me he was your favorite student, so I think we could get some arguments from that table over there. And the rest of some of Soup's buddies from New Haven. So I would just like to have that table please stand up. Please stand. Remain standing. I'd just like to do a toast for Soup. And also my good friend and Soup's great friend, Larry White, is at that table. And I'd like to have all of Soup's teammates stand up, all his great Friar teammates, please, that are in attendance tonight. Just like to make a toast for Soup. Just remaining standing, and of course, Dominic, wherever you're sitting, Dominic, please stand. I'd like to have all these guys stand while I give a toast. Sorry. And along with everyone else in the room, please, let's all raise our glasses. Let's all raise our glasses to number 23, who I know is smiling down on all of us. Congratulations, Soup, on your jersey when you retired. What an honor and well-deserved. We all love you and miss you. God bless Soup and God bless all Friars. Cheers and thank you very much.
Come on, one more time. Soup, yeah. Thank you, John, that was great. Next up, this is indeed a real honor for me. I had a privilege of watching her play for a while when she was still at Providence College. And through my own efforts, when I began many, many years ago, I started my athletic career working for the great Donna Lopiano and Jody Conrad at the University of Texas. And while they were trailblazers in their own right for women's athletics in this country, I don't think I ever saw anybody as impressive to me in the sport that she chose to play than Cammy Granato when she laced up skates. Here is Cammy Granato.
I had never seen Cammy play. She was recommended by a youth coach who had an opportunity to see her play. And he said that Cammy would probably be one of the top players in women's collegiate hockey. So I flew her out with her mother, and it was a great weekend. When I first met her, I knew right then and there that this girl would be something special, and I still hadn't seen her step on the ice.
Anybody who's watched her play knows she's got just an absolutely natural goal-scoring ability and just had a great hockey sense, like Gretzky, which you can't teach.
Cammy's hockey skills were the innate skills. She's got a great knack for scoring. She just has hockey sense. She's always in the right place at the right time, and that's what made her so good.
I saw her playing and I said, man, this kid is way ahead of everybody else.
What made her so valuable to our team, outside of the incredible statistics that she had, was more that she was a team first player.
We had fun. We had a lot of good times. We had some adversity that we met. We had injuries. At one point, we didn't really have a goalie. It's the way I think the kids came together and the team came together. And Cammy, obviously, was so instrumental in that, if you just look at scoring records.
She was always there. After practice was over, people would leave the ice. We'd stick around. She'd practice one-timers over and over and over. There was extra ice to be had. We'd be out there playing 2-on-2, 3-on-3, extra time in the weight room. She did it all.
There really is a reason that she would be compared to someone like a Wayne Gretzky. She just understood where to be. She had a hockey sense that even the really good athletes today, no one quite had it like she had it.
She certainly inspired me to come here. We had met at a development camp when I was in high school. And there was nice representation from Providence, Northeastern, UNH, all great hockey players, all great kids. There's just something different about her. A lot of people focus on her hockey, but as a person, she's a wonderful person too. She's very kind.
At the end of the day, we won two championships with Cammy, and we could have won a third. And after she graduated, we won two more championships, and I think that was probably because of the kind of work ethic and the kind of preparation that she left with the players in that locker room once she had graduated.
Everything we could do to stay focused every day and just concentrate on the task at hand, which was winning a gold medal, it was such a dream come true for us that we never really thought was a reality, that being together on the ice the night we won was just surreal.
It really encompassed everyone's hard work and the friendships you made along the way, and really grinding and competing and finding ways to be better as a team and better as an individual athlete. It really was a culmination of all of that in that moment. And I think the best part about that team was that no one had done it before.
She was probably the first female that little girls got to know due to her time on the U.S. national team. So lots of young girls grew up with the number 21. There's actually a player on the U.S. national team with the number 21 because of Cammy Granato.
Most people associate Cammy with USA Hockey, but there was a long road to get there. Started in Downers Grove and worked her way to Providence and worked hard. And everything Cammy achieved, she earned on her own.
Still to this day, all her records and accolades still make her one of the best. She was inducted into the Hockey Hall of Fame in Toronto in 2012 as the first female hockey player. Those two things combined just show what an amazing player she was.
anytime you're recognized in this kind of way on this stage brings attention to the sport. It brings attention to Cammie's accomplishments and what she's done here.
I know for us it's a proud moment for the Providence Women's Ice Hockey program. You know, how can you not be proud of her?
She was just a pleasure to work with. I don't want to say coach because you don't coach players like Cammie Granato. You just let them play.
Cammie, congratulations from the Providence College Women's Ice Hockey Program. All of our former players, present players, coaches and staff, we couldn't think of a better recipient, and what an honor, not just for you, but for our women's hockey program. To have our first jersey retired is quite an honor, and there couldn't be a more deserving recipient than yourself. Again, congratulations, Cammie.
Please welcome to the stage Providence College head coach Bob Durrani and Cammie Granato.
Thank you. Thank you so much for this honor. I want to thank Providence and Father Shanley, the athletic department, Bob Driscoll, who can't be here, and Harold and Steve for getting me here, even though I was a day late with the weather. I'm really happy that I got to be here tonight. I also want to thank Bob Durrani and the women's hockey department, Bob's enthusiasm and love for women's hockey and women's sport and what he's done to carry the Friar women's hockey team's name, you know, along, and just, you've been amazing, and make us that have graduated feel really special when we come back. I also want to congratulate the other nominees, Lou and Ron, Doris and Otis, and the late Sue Campbell. I don't get back to Providence as much as I'd like to. The last 14 years I've lived out in Vancouver, and it's quite a long way, but I realize when I do come back that part of me feels like I'm coming home. And I think that's just because of the years I spent here were just so influential, so memorable. The greatest time for me to play hockey, really, because I had watched my brothers get college scholarships, and I was always so defeated that women couldn't play college hockey. I had no idea that there was women's college hockey until I was like a bantam, 12, 13 years old. So to come and play every day, play hockey every day at Providence was just, it was a dream come true for me. When I look at how I ended up here, it was pretty interesting. I was playing hockey with boys my whole life in Illinois. I never knew another girl at the time in my town that played. And you know, there was no internet, there was no social media, there was no, you know, global scope on hockey or anything else. So I just thought I was the only one. I wasn't until I was, I think, a bantam, and one of the dads on the team had mentioned that there was hockey out east, that he had a relative that played at Providence College. And he handed me this stat sheet, and I'll never forget, I hung on to this thing. I couldn't believe, first of all, that women played hockey, other women, because I just was so used to playing with boys my whole life and never met any other women's hockey players. That stat sheet had Cindy Curley on the top of it, leading the team by a margin of points. And I remember studying that and looking at that and saying, I want to do this. I want to be at the top of that stat sheet like Cindy Curley. And she became my first ever women's hockey idol. And I want to thank her. She's not here, but she was one of the best hockey players I had ever seen. And she doesn't get the credit she deserves because there were no Olympics when she played. She was a true, true pioneer and incredibly dominant, an amazing leader. And really, I feel like if there were Olympics when she was playing, she'd be standing up here. She would have been the first U.S. women in the Hall of Fame. She was that dominant, that good, and that great of a leader. So Cindy, I know you're not here, but thank you for being my mentor and my first ever women's hockey idol, and always my first ever women's hockey idol. So getting back to my story about getting to Providence, when I learned about the school, my parents, we booked a trip out east. Somehow we're in touch, my parents, with Coach Marchetti. And I remember walking into the office for a visit. We went to a couple other schools, but he was really interested and showed so much, I guess, faith in me because he had never seen me play hockey. He was just going on word of mouth. And nobody else recruited me. There were no recruitment letters. There was nothing going on in Illinois to recruit any hockey players. We didn't even really know much about it. So he believed in me. And I didn't have a plan B to play hockey anywhere else. If I didn't get into Providence, I was going to Wisconsin to play soccer. And actually hadn't gotten into Providence when I was supposed to. But every day, Coach Marchetti was at the admissions office trying to get me in. So 4 weeks before my freshman year, he called me and he says, "You're in. I got you in. I don't have a dorm room for you. I've got a little place that I'm gonna rent that you're gonna stay. That you're gonna rent. Like it was a little house, basement suite with another girl that was coming in, because there was no dorm space that late. But I got in, and it was a major, you know, decision, because I don't know what would have happened had I gone to Wisconsin. Would I have quit hockey? I don't know. Would I have come a year later? I just don't know. So I'm so thankful for Coach Marchetti. And he was supposed to be here tonight coming from Florida, but he's not. And I'm so sad that I didn't get to see him, because I really wanted to tell him, you know, looking back now that I'm older, I really realize how much he did for us. He bent over backwards to help us. Every single day he was pushing to make women's hockey more of a part of the school, more equal rights for us, more ice time in comparison to the men, or equal ice time in comparison to the men. So he was the guy who really believed in us and pushed for us. So Coach Marchetti, thank you. I also want to thank my teammates, especially Michelle Johansson, who you saw in the video. She was my roommate all the way through college. Chris Bailey, a dear, dear friend of mine. And all my teammates, even my U.S. teammates that came tonight, thank you so much. When I came into the lobby and I saw all the girls that I played with, and I hadn't seen, you know, since we graduated, some of them, it's like we were right back there together again, laughing and sharing those memories. And I wanted to make sure everyone recognized them, because a lot of times the credit goes to certain players for scoring goals, but I think what you really know in a team, it's a team sport, and everybody is a pioneer here that played the game, and everybody should be recognized. So if you guys, teammates and Friar hockey players, stand up, a couple USA hockey players, stand up, please recognize these guys. And I just want to say I'm so proud to be part of the Friar family, and thank you so much for this honor.
Congratulations, Cammy. There was a time in another lifetime for me anyway, back in the 1980s, when I had the privilege of working in the NBA as an announcer, and I hated Otis Thorpe. Hated him. It's because I worked in San Antonio, so Otis, you'll forgive me, you understand, right? But I never saw anybody as powerful or as graceful at the same time as Otis Thorpe was. And I remember Stan Albeck, who was our coach for a while, and later Cotton Fitzsimmons, who was our coach for a while, used to just rave about Otis Thorpe. And we're going to rave about Otis Thorpe tonight, too. Here's Otis Thorpe's video.
Our recruitment of Otis Thorpe turned out to be incredibly fortuitous in that there was like a semi-legal guardian, Phyllis Freed, whose son Chip went to the Princeton basketball camp in the summer of 79. And through that connection, Coach Carrill got in touch with me and said that they thought that they had a player that was capable of playing at Providence College. At the time, Otis was playing in Boynton Beach. He basically hadn't started playing until he was in the 11th grade. So he was a total diamond in the rough.
Gary Walters asked me to go and check this player out. Well, I went down to Florida, and I was pleasantly surprised when I got down there. It was a 6'9", 220-pound body, beautiful human being that ran like a gazelle. He was terrific underneath. He could rebound. He was strong. He could run the floor. He could use the left, use the right.
Providence was really the only college recruiting Otis at the time. And then as the season went on, all of a sudden, right out of the clear blue sky, just when we're trying to close the deal and getting Otis to come to Providence, Denny Crum from Louisville, who they were the national champs, Norm Sloan at Florida, they really tried to come hard after Otis, but thank God Otis held to his commitment at Providence, and the rest is history.
And even with that body, he was able to get up and down the court. He's strong as a bull, he can rebound, he can run. And I remember telling people that Otis was going to be a pro. And Otis was a really humble guy, you know, he was an easygoing guy until he got on the court, then he was killer.
Otis was like a sponge, not only as a student, but also when it came to playing basketball. As a student, he was the kind of guy that had a hell of a memory. He could really prepare for an exam the day of the exam and do very well because he had that photographic memory.
It's going to take any player, no matter how good you are, no matter how talented you are, it's going to take you a little while, especially a freshman, to just the nuances of Gary's offense and his defenses.
Gradually, he got better and better in terms of understanding what our expectations were. And as the year went on, he became, I would say in the last month of the season, even as a freshman, at that point, a dominant player in the Big East.
He was a raw talent that just started to come into his own. And his freshman year, he was sort of very inquisitive. You know, what can I do? What can I be? By his sophomore year, he started to figure it out. Like, geez, you know, I got to go against this guy, and I got, you know, a couple more rebounds than he did, and I got a couple of more points than that guy did during the course of the game. Maybe I'm that good. You know, that guy could have been Pat Ewing, you know, Ed Pinckney.
You think a lot of great names, Michael Adams, Chris Mullin, and the fact that Otis held his own against those guys night in, night out was pretty phenomenal.
You don't play 17 years in the NBA unless you're good, especially at strong forward. In Otis's case, his playing 17 years is a testament to his work ethic.
There's not many players that you could think of that had such an outstanding NBA career. If you talk to some of the best there is out there, if you talk to Dream, if you talk to Barkley, if you talk to any of those guys, they certainly will speak highly of Otis.
Hi, I'm Dickie Simpkins, PC Friar alum 1994. I want to say congratulations to my PC Friar brother, mentor, and friend, Otis Thorpe, for having his jersey number 33 retired and raised in the rafters. It's a great achievement and honor for you and your family to enjoy and embrace this moment. If I think back on Otis Thorpe, big OT, I think about playing against him in the NBA. And believe me, when I tell you this, nobody knows this, but Otis Thorpe was pound for pound the strongest guy that I've ever played against in the NBA. OT, congratulations on having your jersey retired. Well deserved and a great honor.
Otis Thorpe, I wanted to be you when I was a kid, watching you play in the dunk. I was born here, I was raised here, and I would always see how many rebounds you would get in the game. To be the longest tenured NBA player from Providence College is an unbelievable honor. To see your jersey retired is unbelievable honor. Feel proud, feel great. I appreciate everything you bring to Friartown. We love when you're at our games, when we're on the road, NCAA tournaments. We are just so proud of you, and I can't tell you how blessed I've been to watch you play, not just as a collegiate, but as a professional. You handle yourself in a first-class manner. Go Friars, go Otis Thorpe.
Please welcome to the stage Friar head coach Ed Cooley and OT, Otis Thorpe.
Sorry about that. Hello, everyone. It's nice to be here. But first of all, I would like to thank the president, Father Shanley, for making this happen. The AD, Bob Driscoll, also Coach Cooley. Great win today, Coach. I enjoyed that. And then also, I want to thank for the hospitality of Harold and Steve. Getting us around and showing us a great time since we've been here. I only been here a short time, got in yesterday. He did a great job. But I got to say one thing I'm grateful for tonight, just to be sharing this moment with my family, my wife, Donella. My daughter, Olivia. And my son, Daniel. Future Friar. But I got to tell you, I think back to the time when Gary Walters and Steve Harker, they did a great job at recruiting me, bringing me here to Providence. At the time, I had to put my trust in their words. One thing that Steve Harker told me, listen, Providence College would be a great school for you and a great opportunity. And I believed him and ended up coming here. But the craziest thing, I always think back to this, where my biggest fear wasn't coming to college. My biggest fear wasn't coming to a new team. My biggest fear was the winters up here. You talking about where in January, I'm walking around in shorts in Florida, but coming up here shopping for Long Johns. That was a huge adjustment for me. But I want to go through this. I hope I don't bore you with this, but the teammates, when Walters and Steve recruited a number of guys that first year, my first year, I brought in like 7 players. First was like George Jackson, you talking about Jim Shalakis. Miles McPartland, you got Carl Hill, Sean Canty, and myself. Then you're talking about the veterans on the team. I remember back, you're talking about Jim Panaggio, you got Rich Unger, Rudy Williams, Jerry Scott, Billy Fields. That was the first guy I ever seen that can shoot so deep outside. The guy had range, unbelievable range. And then Ricky Tucker, this guy never stopped moving, all the time moving. I just had to give him a nickname. I just started calling him Spark Plug. This guy was incredible. But over the years, and then you talking about the second year in the, with the school, 2 more recruits came in. Ron Jackson, he's here tonight. This guy had incredible scoring ability. You're talking about a guy that had deep range also. And then the next guy, I guess everybody know him in here, he called himself Magic. Keith Lomax. At least that's what he said for us to call him, Magic. So that was the second year here. The third year, there was a new crop that came in. It was Ray Knight, Al Raw, Dick Pennefather, West Coast, Donnie Brown, and your main man, H, Harold Stocks. That's the first time seeing this guy. He just reminded me of a football player. The guy was just built. I'm like saying, this guy's playing for the basketball team. But everything worked out because when we needed this guy to play defense, he was there. He did it for us. I got to take my hat off to him. That guy did a great job. My fourth year, I guess you guys would know these guys anyway because of what they did afterwards that time. It was Yaksik Duda, Dave Kipper. You're talking about Brian Wallers, and Pop Lewis and Billy Donovan. And Billy was one of those guys. You're talking about be the best that you could be. That was the guy that I thought of Billy being the best that you could be. And the guys that are here, I want to tell you, in my 4 years being here, I want to let y'all know, you guys were not only teammates. You guys were my family. And I appreciate that. Thank you. Before I leave, I got to say this because I got to tell you, it was great, great being here at Providence College. And it was great being here in the city of Providence. But I got to tell you, it is great being a Friar. Thank you, guys.
Otis, thank you. Fantastic. We're going to slip back to the ice for just a moment, and let's take a look back at Lou Lamoriello.
He came from a tremendous family. His mother was a great Italian cook, and I can remember having several meals out there. His father was a wonderful man, and that's the best you can say about a person is their family, and he certainly had a good one.
He was maybe the hardest working guy in practice. He always working, always trying to improve, always working on his shot, which he had a cannon for a shot.
It was a lot of fun. We played in the old Rhode Island Auditorium. There weren't a lot of ice rinks around, so that was the place.
First year there, it was chicken wire. A couple of years later, they put glass in there and it wasn't too bad.
In those days, people smoked, so if there was a big crowd there, the smoke would filter up high and you couldn't see the people in the top rows of the arena.
For us to get a new stick, we had to take back the two pieces of the stick back to Steve in the equipment room.
I think it made you skate harder, to be honest with you, when you were always battling to get ice, whether it be out in Borrowville on a pond, out at Louis' house in Johnston. But it was a very enjoyable and I wouldn't trade it for $1 million.
Lou comes off as a traditionalist, but as a coach, he was an innovator. We did things that people would laugh at this being innovative, but we stretched. We did a stretching program that no one did back then.
Lou, I think, was the first one to bring in the trap system.
We all blocked shots. He made us wear ankle guards, which I had never worn in my life.
We all had to have the same kind of tape on our sticks, black tape. Black tape on our black socks, white tape on our white socks. And one day, my helmet wasn't fitting properly. I put some foam inside of it to fix it. And I held the foam into my helmet with a little white tape that curled onto the back of my white helmet. White tape on a white helmet, about a quarter of an inch. And I go into the locker room and Lou has my helmet. And he goes, "What's this?" I said, "Oh," I was kind of proud of the job I did. I said, "I put this foam in there, my helmet doesn't go down anymore." He said, "No, you've got white tape on the back of your helmet." And I said, "Well, nobody can see it." He said, "Your helmet is different. Get it off."
The intensity was always there and the honesty was always there. First day, last day, you treated you the same.
Lots of rules, lots of curfews. We had curfew two nights before a game at 11 o'clock. Not just in your room, in bed, asleep, no lights, no radio, nothing.
As you talk to professors around the school, they knew Lou, what he expected of the team, and they would talk to us about that.
He showed me how to take a penalty shot. Well, hell, I think it was two games later, I get a penalty shot. Did what he said, put it right in the upper corner, I think it was against Northeastern, and I came skating back, and he just had that smile on his face, and he said, "You were going too slow."
He bought a bunch of cheap watches, And once in a while, when he'd get upset, he'd take his watch off and he'd fire it off the wall. And he'd walk out of the room and he'd just wink at me like, you know, I hope they got the message, but I'm not that upset anyway.
Lou was really good about identifying individuals and what made them tick and how he could get the most out of everybody. And I use my brother and myself as an example all the time. We are night and day, and you cannot treat my brother the way you would treat me, and if you did, you're not going to get the most out of either one of us. But Lou knew exactly how he needed to coach my brother Scott, and he knew exactly how he needed to coach me, and that filtered itself right through the locker room. He got the most out of everybody.
I needed a coach like that, and I went to Providence College as a green 18-year-old kid from Minnesota, and I left as a man with a proper work ethic and a good sense of how to do things.
If it wasn't for building Schneider Arena, Providence College probably wouldn't have hockey now.
Schneider was really special for us. As it was being built, we got a chance to go down and see what stages of construction. And the coach had so many great ideas for the handles on the doors, on the benches, how long the seating was. You see his signature all over that rink.
The one thing that Lou taught me and taught all of his players was, you know, work ethic is important, but so too is professionalism. And I think the one thing that I really grasped from Lou was the degree of professionalism that it takes to be successful.
It wasn't just the four-year window that he had you for. I think he was helping to prepare you for life after Providence College.
Some of the values we learned from him, things like competitiveness, teamwork, discipline. Those are things that we've taken in our personal life and taken into our business careers.
I sometimes wonder what would have happened to me had that not been my destiny to play for a coach like Lou Lamoriello and go to a college like Providence. Was I lucky? Yeah, and I was blessed, but I also tried hard. And that's what Coach Lamoriello insisted that we do.
I really believe that the people who've helped you get to where you are, you have to be loyal to him. And Lou was always loyal to myself and a number of other players who obviously went out and, you know, did the job. And he just directed us.
He had a great college career as a player, great college career as a coach and administrator. And he's had a great pro career, 3 Stanley Cups, Hockey Hall of Fame. His attention to detail, his insistence on excellence, continues to this day, and he's not done.
Our program is very honored to have Lou's jersey retired tonight, not only as a player, but also as a coach and athletic director. He was the architect of not only our program, but also of Schneider Arena. He built Providence College hockey not only with the success he had on the ice, but with how the players were off the ice. The tradition he built here is something that our program strives to obtain every day on the ice and in the classroom. It's truly an honor for all of our players and our coaches to be part of this program that Lou Lamoriello built. I want to thank him, and I also like to congratulate him.
Hello, everyone. I understand I'm speaking after the video, and I haven't seen it, so I have no idea what you are watching. I would like to tell you that it is a complete honor to be recognized by Providence College. I came in as a 16-year-old, left as a 20-year-old, not knowing what I would be doing the rest of my life. And without the education that I received from the Dominicans, I would not have had the good fortune that I've had today. I want to apologize for not being there this evening, but because of my commitments in Toronto, it was impossible for me to stay this evening. But please enjoy the evening, enjoy each other, and go Friars.
Please welcome back to the stage Providence head coach Nate Lehman and Lou's son Chris Lamoriello, class of 94.
Well, as my dad said, unfortunately he couldn't be here tonight, and we were talking outside before we came in, and Doris and Otis and I, and they saw me writing some things down, and Otis said, "You prepared a speech," and I said, "Yeah, I wanted to make sure when you're speaking for someone that you make sure you represent them appropriately." And Otis said, "Well, you know, what should I do?" And Doris spoke up right away and said, "Speak from the heart." So Otis, great job. I think that's what all of us here that went to Providence College feel like we do all the time, speak from the heart. And as my dad said, he was able to come last night. Toronto was not playing. And if a lot of you do know him, there's a lot of former teammates and players here, know that when he makes a commitment, and at 74, he's still 100% committed to what he's doing, and to not be there tonight against Buffalo this late in the season, he just couldn't do it. So I thank everyone for understanding that. He called me twice today and still felt guilty about not being here. So I just want to let everyone know how important this is for him. And as everyone, I think, so far tonight has talked about what Providence College has meant and done for them, I'd like to thank Harold Starks for all his time and efforts bringing everyone together tonight. Harold was a great Friar on the court and certainly a great Friar off the court. My dad, AD in 83, so Harold, you were one of his players. My world got opened up outside of the rink in 83 when we got exposed to the other sports. And again, Harold, a great Friar on and off the court. Steve Napolillo, for representing the athletic department, and Bob Driscoll tonight. Jen Cunningham, and Joe Hulbig, was a great Friar and has worked in the development office for a number of years now, and done a lot of work here with the alumni to get everyone together, and certainly, in my opinion, has helped with Nate rejuvenate the hockey program. Father Shanley, I know a lot of us, and I'll speak for some of those, when you were appointed president, we were excited to have an alumnus, someone of your age. The timing, Mike Leonard always refers to timing, at which you came in, couldn't have been any more perfect. What you've done for the school, the ability for you to establish the foundation, certainly the success that you've had, and the preparation for success going forward. Cammy had mentioned coming back, and those of us that are around a little bit more, and some of us like my dad who hadn't been around in a bit, see what's going on campus. It's amazing to see the transformation. Bob Driscoll, you know what you've done, and he's not here tonight, but Steve, the athletic department in the last number of years, and some of the trials a number of years ago that the athletic department went through, what's happened in the recent years and the success, and certainly the positioning for success moving forward with coaches like Nate Lehman, Ed Cooley, great win today, Ed, and certainly Nate last night. What's happened is great to see. The school is continuing to grow, which when all of us went here, I don't think any of us could have imagined it getting bigger, and it has. And not only bigger in size, but bigger right here. So, again, good luck, gentlemen, with the rest of the winter sports and your drive to the playoffs. My dad was very fortunate, the timing. He mentioned being 16 years old when he came here. And the story was he was supposed to go to prep school. And my understanding, that lasted 2 days. And he told his parents it wasn't going to work, whatever they were teaching him. And I don't even know what prep school it was at. Just wasn't going to work. So he was lucky enough to get into Providence College, and Father Schneider, who we all know in name. I'm not sure if I met. I was born in 72. Maybe I did, but I didn't remember it. And like Double B said, Bob Elmore, I don't think there would have been a hockey program if Father Schneider wasn't here when he was. Double B, the auditorium, for the people that know it, you could cut the smoke with a scissor. And I know one thing, my dad wasn't going to stay around for that. And lucky enough, Father Schneider, you see the shovels in the ground. Some of those pictures I haven't seen. Mrs. Gavitt, it's great that you're here. wouldn't have happened without Father Schneider, and I think Double B said before, I don't know if there would have been a hockey program. And I guess we'll never know, but he got it done. And the values that he instilled in my dad, I found out last night the reason he has number 14 was because of Father Schneider. And that was one of his favorite numbers. So whatever they saw in each other at the time, and it just worked. So Father Schneider, what else can we say? The rink's appropriately named after him, and we'll carry his name forever and should. Father Bagley, another big influence on my dad's life, and we hear about the Dominicans and what they've done, but again, Father Bagley, another very important person in my dad's life. Father Taylor, I don't know how many of you know Father Taylor. I know there's just a few here that do. Father Taylor lived in a white house, which was right on the corner of the field hockey field that's there now near Peterson and the cemetery. And I know some of you are looking at me like there was a house there. There was. And Father Taylor would be there every night, sitting on the steps. And every time we drove by, we'd see him. And it was almost like he was the caretaker of the campus. He baptized me. Don't remember a lot about him, but he was always there. And again, a big part of my dad's life. My dad was very fortunate when he played hockey and baseball here that he had two coaches at the time, Tom Eccleston and Alex Nahegian in baseball. And he felt that they were far ahead of their time in what he was teaching the players, the lessons on and off the field and the ice that he'd exposed the players to, the demands on excellence. Again, felt he was very fortunate to have both of those people at that time in his young life. And freshmen couldn't play on varsity. So in those years, and I think maybe it went up until 1974 or 5, freshmen couldn't play. So my dad only played 3 years and was so fortunate to have those two people around him that early in his life. Mrs. Gavitt, again, Dave was such a big influence in my dad's life. People don't know, my dad was a very good baseball player at Cape Cod League, was drafted his junior year of college by the Giants. My dad and Dave roomed together in down the Cape. And in this weird world of fate, like Mike Leonard likes to talk about, the only person I ever heard my dad call coach. Harold asked me, we make sure your dad's here, and he mentioned a few names, and then he mentioned your name, and I said, that's probably the only one that could probably make sure he was there. So thank you, and certainly Dave, everybody knows what Dave Gavitt's meant to Providence College. He was, again, far ahead of his time, and to see his picture and see the basketball players that are here tonight that played for him and listen to Otis talk about that, and certainly Soup, it's unbelievable. Before I get to some of the other people, I just want to make sure the honorees tonight, it's great to relive some of these memories. I was here for some of them, wasn't for others. Otis Tharp, probably one of the greatest athletes Providence College has seen. Probably one of my dad's biggest failures. He couldn't get you on the ice. 'Cause he would have won, I can tell you that. Great career in college and NBA champion, 17 years. What else can you say? Congratulations. Soup Campbell, Justin, your dad, the versatility and talent as a player only rivaled by his value as a teammate and a friend. To listen to those stories and hear teammates talk about him, the way people speak of him, congratulations. Great man. Doris, your career was starting to take off at Providence, and it seems like it's still going. The reach that you have, the representation as a professional with Providence College in your life is, for all of us, a great sense of pride, and it was great spending some time with you before. Ronnie, Bradley, and Randy. Bradley and Randy were great players here, great scorers. When you listen about the point totals that all of them had, it's scary, and You know, Bradley had some injuries, careers cut short, and Randy, I don't know, when Billy Milner talks about the goals he scores as a freshman, 30 goals, Nate, as a freshman, it's scary. The shot that Randy had, and certainly the work ethic, the competition that Bradley provided, like Billy said, it's tough to win faceoffs, and to remember a player is not losing one is a heck of a way to remember a hockey player. Ronnie was, like everybody's seen and heard about, great athlete, great person. You talk about being a great teammate, the sacrifice, great NHL career as a coach. Not many great players become great coaches, and certainly Ronnie was one of them. And little tidbit, 96 World Cup, like Bradley talked about, was a big moment, and Ron DiGregorio's here tonight in USA Hockey history. They trained at Providence College. Not sure why, with my dad and Ronnie, but they trained here. So that was a great start to that team coming together and practicing outside in NHL City. And Cammy, what can you say? Hockey Hall of Fame, U.S. Hockey Hall of Fame, Olympics, gold medal. Points, you stop counting when you get in the category like you and Ronnie do. Just know that you were going to do it every night. And what you said about John Marchetti, I guess that house was lined up because he didn't see you play, huh? So what a great way and to talk about your teammates. And congratulations, great career, and certainly in PC history. At the time, all of you ladies and a lot of here tonight, what you did at that time, you know, way ahead of your time. So congratulations. The rink, obviously, big part of Providence College hockey. Can't do that alone. Bob Belmore, who we've seen up on the screen quite a bit, went to high school with my dad, college with my dad, played baseball, hockey, coached with my dad 15 years here, went to New Jersey with him for 4 or 5 years. Wouldn't have been able to do it without him. They were a tag team. As head coaches know, you need assistants to balance out some of the things that you do, and boy, Double B did that. I don't know about some of the things he said. That's the first time I've seen a bow tie on my dad. My kids were laughing. So I've learned some things in the last 24 hours, which is great to be able to see. People at the rink who helped my dad in that process, Dennis Barkley, Bob Riondo, coming over from East Providence, Dudley Richards, the hours that they would spend. I think the college would be broke if they had to pay those two fellas by the hour. Andy Auld, who's still working at the school today, class of 66, Ray Rossi, Eddie Bucacci, Steve Aquino, a credit to that whole, I guess, liftoff in Schneider Arena and the history there. When my dad coached his last year in 83, Dave left, I believe, to join the Big East as commissioner, and Father Peterson was the president of the school at the time. And Father Peterson was another very influential figure in my dad's life. And Father Peterson, my dad said, called him at 4 a.m. and said that he was going to be the next AD. And I don't know if my dad knew what to think. And I think when, I don't know if he asked him on the call or when things settled down, he said, well, what about coaching hockey? And Father Peterson had this way of looking with his glasses and his eyes, and he looked at him and said, well, you can't coach. And he said, well, I don't know if I want to take the job. And I don't know if it went exactly like that, but basically I think it was a mini negotiation, and Father Peterson looked at him and said, I'll let you do it for a year. And then I think you'll know why I'm saying you can't do it. He did it for a year and found out he couldn't do both jobs. And it'd be a disservice to the school, to the rest of the athletic department, and the student athletes to do that. And I think it was very tough for him because he was taken off a team, which for him was, I guess, the best part of what he ever did, playing, coaching, and now managing. Big decision in his life, but Father Peterson, Father Tom, Father John, unfortunately, who we lost a few weeks ago, the support that they gave him to be able to sacrifice, and Bradley talked about sacrifice earlier, to do what they thought was right, what he thought was right, couldn't be done. And again, it goes back to the Dominican influence and the support. My dad doesn't like speaking about himself. We don't talk a lot about personal achievements, but the Dominicans and what they provided to him in support, what they did for all the other student athletes at the school, the students, the administrators, the faculty, we can't go without recognizing. And again, he would not have the opportunities and fortunes he's had today without that influence. John Marinato was a big part of his transformation, the athletic department. It was a small school, as we've talked about and we've listened to tonight, and John was a big part in supporting that transition. In 87, he made another big decision. I don't think he ever thought he'd leave Providence College, but he did, and I think the only reason he left because there was a chance to get back on a team. Even though he was on a team here, it was a team, not 20 of them. And for him, that was something, I think, that the challenge was there. He learned from Dave that sometimes there's some things that you may not want to do, but you should do. And everything that, you know, he's always done is what he's felt has been the right thing because of the work ethic and the dignity and the professionalism and the experiences that he had, you know, way back as a 16-year-old. And but last night coming back and being around everyone, you know, made him realize that he never really left. And it's hard to believe it's been, I think, 30 years now. You know, that he hasn't been around full time, and I think five since he was. So lastly, for me, I'd like to just thank all of his players that are here, and certainly all the players he's had over the years. He treated all of you and thought of all of you like sons, and I think Father talked about it earlier. For him, you always separated the person from the player, and that was a very important part of the way he coached, a very important part of the way that he wanted to be around people and certainly around his players. And being there last night for him and seeing the players that were there, I know was big. He remembers all of you. He remembers your stats. He remembers what you did well. He remembers what you still need to work on and off the ice. Like Kenny Richards had said, he was all about the details. And again, for me, it's great. He doesn't tell stories. I hear them from you guys. Some I don't want to hear, some I do. But you've all treated me like a brother. So for me, it's been great. And Father Shanley, I'll just leave you with one thing. And I know you spoke to it earlier. And for me, I think it's something that he's always lived by. And student athlete was anytime he ever referenced any player that he had here. And he was a very good student. He was also a teacher at Johnston High for a short period of time. So he always knew the value of education and where it's carried him all these years. And you think about athletics and how do you put a value on athletics. And when you hear the stories tonight, when you think about teammates talking about teammates, when you look at everybody that's up here and the first thing that people talk about is how good a person they are, when you hear about how they do things for others, they don't want to talk about themselves. You hear about sacrifice, you hear about commitment. Patriots win, all they want to talk about is team. I think that's the best example of what athletics can provide. And I think the opportunity that all of the people here tonight have had internationally, locally, to be able to pass that message on. Listen to Ed Cooley talk to people, you know, an hour before the game, which is difficult to do. Nate knows when you're going into, Bob knows, Durrani, a big game. It's difficult to settle your nerves and not give people the time and attention and focus that you should when you're around them. And I think athletics allows people, and certainly all these people behind us here, to present that message of Providence College because they are where they are, and they have had the fortune because of this foundation that they had here. And I know you know the value of that as a student, as an administrator, and I just want to let you know that's what I was grown up on. That's all I ever heard, and I do think it means something. And again, nobody wants to talk about themselves. They want to talk about their teammates. So thank you for allowing me to share Thank you for allowing me to share a little bit about my dad, which for him is tough to do. For us, it's even tougher. My kids laugh when they see those photos. They've never seen him with hair. So that's quite an interesting photo for them to see. But Vicky, who I met here at Providence College, we've been married 20 years, three kids later. What else can we say at Providence College? Thank you.
Chris, thank you, and congratulations to your dad. Before we introduce Doris Burke, just a quick little item. I have to admit that when I heard that Doris was being inducted, it reminded me of a story of about 12 years ago. I'm sitting watching a college basketball game with my youngest son, Austin, who was about 10 years old at the time. And Doris popped up on the screen, and she's doing an interview. And I think it might have been Mike Krzyzewski. I'm not quite certain, but I think it was. And I looked, and my son, Austin, was watching very intently. And I said, just kind of offhanded, you know how parents are. They love to impress their kids. I said, I know her. And he looked at me kind of quizzically and goes, you know Doris Burke? Yeah, I know Doris. And so sensing an opportunity to really impress my son, I said, yeah, I kind of sort of gave her start in this business. And she filled in the radio for us a few times back in about 1993, 94, I think it was when it was. And he looks at me and he goes, you know Doris Burke? Yeah, I know Doris Burke, sensing that it wasn't going anywhere. But the true story of it is that John Marinato, the athletic director at the time, came to me and he said, Doris came to me and she really would like to get involved in broadcasting. Think she'd be really good at it. Is there a way that we can fit her in somehow? And so we used Doris in a couple of our men's games on the radio at the time when Joey was traveling, and she did a superb job, better than I ever expected. Doris, I still have those clips, by the way, so if you ever want them, we could send them to the Hall of Fame or something, maybe. At any rate, she's one of our Hall of Famers now, isn't she? Let's take a look back at Doris Burke.
I remember one of the games we were playing against UConn. At one point, it was getting really rough, and Doris took an elbow to the mouth. And all of a sudden, you know, to my shock, I'm seeing blood in her mouth and on the court. And the trainer went immediately over to Doris to help her. And she spit out her front tooth.
Anybody else, including myself, I think, would have just ran into the locker room and cried our eyes out. But Doris is tough. I mean, she's New Jersey tough.
The trainer's working on her. She's gauzing her up just to stop the bleeding. And I just couldn't believe it that all of a sudden the horn's blowing and she's getting subbed back in, toothless.
The year before I came to Providence College, I was coaching at Penn State and we played at Providence. And Providence at that time had some great talent, Britt King, Joni Powers, Mary Burke. But what I liked about them was their point guard, Doris Sable, who was a tough, gritty, New Jersey type kid that would do anything it takes to win the game.
You know, we pushed the ball down the floor and she kicked it out to me and I took a shot, it didn't fall. Some kind of break, whether that be at a timeout or a free throw, she'd be like, you know, Mary Burke, I'm gonna kick that ball right back to you and you're gonna make it.
You never ever wanted to be around Doris when Providence took the lead against an opponent and the opponent's coach had to call a timeout. Doris would be jumping in the air and she'd be flailing her arm, and when she made it over to the bench, she'd want to give you a high five. And if you were the recipient of the high five, you wouldn't be able to feel your hand for days.
Our junior Bob Foley came in and he established up-tempo transition style, which I consider back then, when I think about 30 years ago, that was a cutting edge. Now it's very common that you see a lot of teams run and push the ball. But my knowledge that I have today, I understand that it has a lot to do with point guards, and I greatly reap the benefit of that.
She could dribble like nobody's business. We did not ever have to practice a press break because we just gave the ball to Doris and she dribbled through it. She was very fast, very quick. If you asked her that question, I guarantee you she would say, no, I'm not fast. But yes, she was lightning quick.
Doris had a great court vision, so if you were open, Doris could find you. We were a team that liked to run and fast break, and she was very good at pushing the ball up. And most of the time, Doris could find me on the court, so that's what made her a great point guard. Once we heard the announcement that we actually had gotten into the NCAA tournament as an at-large, and we were hosting, we were just so excited.
We were just this little Providence College with 4,000 students. James Madison came into our home court.
It was a close game the whole time, and I'll never forget it. I can still see the shot. Betsy Whitman hit about a 14-foot baseline jumper.
She was a great shooter, and she actually hit a shot on the baseline to actually win the game. We had one last shot. In fact, I was the one that shot the last shot and I missed it, but it was a very, very close game, a great crowd, great atmosphere.
I do remember I was playing the girl who shot the winning basket to beat us by two. So not a fond memory.
It kind of put Providence College on the map a little bit more, that we were able to take that next step, get to the NCAA tournament, and really put a great step forward.
When Doris decided to join the staff, she knew how tough I could be on players. It was never a problem for her, but some of our other players were very sensitive. And we played good cop, bad cop a lot. Unfortunately, I was always the bad cop.
She's incredibly patient. She listens, she's caring, and in the coaching world, those attributes are priceless.
She actually took Shania Evans under her wing, and Shania Evans became one of the best point guards in the country by her senior year, and that was with Doris's help.
A lot of times people, especially now, and if they know we're friends, they'll say, oh my gosh, Doris is such an exceptional commentator. You know, she really knows the game, and I love listening to her. And I always say, I'm so happy for her and her success because it's wonderful when great people, wonderful human beings are this successful.
Going into the broadcasting field with the experience as a player and a coach gave her a leg up on a lot of people. She's very determined. She works very hard at her craft.
I think she was always a confident person because I think you play your personality on the court. But then when you get exposed to other opportunities once your competitive career is over, really speaks volumes about, you know, really who she was internally, what she was, you know, willing to do, and really continue to take women to the forefront of the men's game, which I think is so important.
We all came from different backgrounds, and I think those backgrounds helped her to be tough in an environment that is overwhelmingly men. And you've got to learn how to survive. And she is clearly a survivor.
Doris, I'm really sorry I can't be here, but I'm so proud of you and what you've accomplished. Every time I see you on TV, I just smile. And I just think of all the great times we had with you as a player and a coach. And I wish you all the best. You're so deserving of this award. And I wish you all the best in your future.
Doris, so happy for you. You deserve this. I'm sorry I couldn't be there tonight, but I am there with you in spirit. So is Paul, Annie, and Matthew. We are so happy for you.
Hi, I'm Billy Donovan, and I'd like to congratulate all the honorees tonight for the Friars legends. I'd like to give a shout out to my former teammate, Otis Thorpe. Congratulations, I'm personally very happy for you. And from one point guard to another, Doris, congratulations on having your jersey retired, well-deserved, and wish everybody a great evening. Thank you.
Doris, congratulations. You're so well-deserving of this incredible award, and I look forward to seeing your jersey, Doris Sable, Providence College, Lady Friar, number 11, hanging from the rafters for the rest of our lives. Congratulations, girl.
Our lady, our first lady, Doris Burke. Dan-a-dan, dan-a-dan, I love seeing you behind the microphone. I love hearing your voice on being not a analyst, the greatest analyst, not in just the NBA, but college basketball as well. You feel the game, you touch the game, you see the game. I can't tell you how proud we are of you, Doris, to see your jersey along with the other jerseys of all the great young men and women that have played at our school. I beam with pride when I talk about Doris Burke. I beam with pride when we hear your voice. My son is a really, really big fan. I'm a big fan of yours. The Friars are big fans. Go Doris Burke.
I'm not even sure what to say about that. But we found her. She's our first lady with Coach Cooley. Doris Burke is here. She's in the house.
Thank you. So don't fire that poor soul who ran that video. That's for when they hang the jersey in Alumni Hall. So whoever, don't feel bad, please. I once cursed on television because somebody hit the wrong button, so please don't stress it. Is there really any wonder that my dating life was not spectacular at Providence College, given how I look back then? And my sister gave me a heck of a piece of advice before I got up here. She said, stand up and be recognized, sit down and be appreciated. Sincerely, everyone, I think every honoree here would thank you all for taking the time and sharing in what is an extraordinary evening. My daughter has done a lot of crying. I'm going to try not to cry, but it will be very hard for me. When I went in the Providence College Hall of Fame, I didn't bring a tissue. Tonight I remembered. I would like to start by congratulating the other honorees. Lou, Ron, Soup, Cammy, Otis. You know, when you come to Providence College or you depart Providence College, there are certain giants here. Giants. And the five people that are going in tonight are truly extraordinary. They're sort of the soul of Providence College. They have meant so much to what is a very small school, but you kept hearing a word over and over tonight, and that was family. So congratulations to all the other honorees and their families. Congratulations. To Brian Shanley and the Dominicans, it's hard for me to imagine where my life would be without the education I received at Providence College. It's very hard for me to imagine. I have been so blessed. I've always felt like the hand of divine providence is in the small of my back, sort of pushing me along to the places I need to be in life. So, to Bob Driscoll and Steve Napolillo and Harold Starks, what they have achieved at Providence College with the support of the president and the board of trustees and all of the people, it's truly the transformation in athletics facilities is nothing short of remarkable. I'm so proud. It's such a competitive landscape, and I so appreciate the hard work. And we have just hired a new women's basketball coach by the name of Jim Crowley. Yeah. The pre-conference schedule, they won probably more games than they had in quite some time. The Big East has sort of brought them their lumps, but he is going to turn this program around, and I'm so happy he's here. I'm the youngest of eight children, a very Irish Catholic family raised on the Jersey Shore, and my brothers and sisters are all here, and they've come by plane, train, and automobile. So it's been a long night, all of you. And I so appreciate you taking the time to be here. To my ESPN family, who's also here, there's a group of very committed professionals at that table, but I would like to say that Rebecca Lobo and Holly Rowe are two of the best teammates. There's not a person in this room who doesn't understand that you go nowhere in life without great teammates, and Rebecca and Holly are two of the best teammates I could ever have, so I'm appreciative they would take the time. There's a number of teammates in the house who have taken the time to be here. Finn, Lo, SJ, Mimi, Sheila, you made me cry. I looked and you made me cry. I'll just tell you a couple stories. I'm a freshman. I'm a point guard. We're down, I think, in Miami, maybe in December. And Kathy Finn taught me a lesson pretty early in my career. And Kathy, along with Andrea Mangum, I think are the two best players to play in the history of this school, women's basketball. We're playing three games in 3 days. We're down in a nip and tuck ball game. It's tied, and Kathy Finn, the coach diagrams of play, the coach at the time was Lynn Sheedy, another great player here. I don't really remember what it was. All I remember is Kathy Finn came up to me and goes, kid, get me the ball. I got her the ball, she hits the shot, we win the game, we walk out of Miami happy. So I'm appreciative. To my friend Sheila, who started as a walk-on and was put on a scholarship, I was very invested in the game. Clearly, you know, how I looked speaks to that. My biggest concern was could I get a jump shot to match my dribble drive ability, and Sheila just looked at me, she's like, you know, you do realize that there's more to life than basketball. There's a place over there called Bradley Cafe. There's another one over there called Pizza Garden, and we're going. So, Sheila, you led me down the path to perdition, and I followed, my friend, and I thank you for that. To my coach, Bob Foley, and I've said this to him many times, every teammate in here is absolutely shocked that he pulled his wallet out and took his wife to Europe, but amen to that. We're so happy for Louise. And I will say, Bob Foley has had a profound influence. He taught us so much in the 2 years I was able to coach for him and then another two with him. And I use the knowledge he taught me every single day in my business. I've been so blessed to have so many good coaches. I'm going to tell you one story, and I think it will sum up what Providence College is about. And it does not reflect very well on me, but I'm going to tell it anyway. So I'm a senior at Providence College, and I've missed a class, and because I've missed the class, I'm going to not start. It's the first time I've not started. And I could use a word that I probably shouldn't, and sweetheart, I won't, because, you know, sorry, you know your mother, I could. But let's just say I did not handle the discipline well. I was really upset that I didn't start. And to make matters worse, my closest friend here, Sheila, was going to start, so you'd think I would have the teammate skills to be happy, but I was sort of acting like an ass, or I said it. And Father Peterson, who we just lost, was at the game that night, as many Dominicans were, and professors, and people showed up because they cared about us first as people, and that was their way to show us that they cared. And I behaved so poorly, I'm almost embarrassed to admit it. But I am walking back to my dorm. I get up the next day, I go to class, I'm walking back to my dorm. And, you know, at every, I don't know if they still do this, but there was always security at the bottom level. And I lived in McVinney Hall at the time, and there's a, you know, these flowers that come in a cup. Well, I walk by it. Look how I look. That was not a flower for men, right? But I, you know, the security guard says, hey, Doris, you know, this is for you. What? And I pick up the cup, and it's a beautiful bouquet of flowers, and there's a handwritten note from Father John Peterson. And Father John held so many roles here, and I don't remember what he was at that time. He might have been the chaplain. And the note said essentially, we expect better. You are better. And when I see you next on the basketball floor, you will be the person we expect you to be. You will be the teammate we expect you to be. And it was, you know, as nice a rebuke and a lesson as you could possibly have. And I've always remembered that story, and I've always thought to myself, I will be the best teammate I can possibly be. And Brian was talking this morning, we had a gathering with the alumni, and he said, they hope at Providence College to blow your mind. They want you to think, and they want you to care, and they want you to be the best person you can possibly be. And I am so indebted to this place and thankful. Before I let you all go, and I will tell you that Sheila will lead the line down to the two bars that are in the building. I would like to thank, I have been so lucky in my life, but I am prouder of nothing than my two children. Sarah and Matthew are kind, and they're caring, and I know they love me very much. And I love them, and I appreciate your patience as your mother has traipsed around the country at various points of your life. But I love you both, and seriously, everyone, thank you so much. It is my honor to be a part of the Providence College family, because that is what we are. We are family.
That's just class right there, isn't it? Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for the evening tonight. We appreciate your patience. Most of all, we appreciate everyone here being a Friar. If we can have our recipients come back up on the stage for one last moment so we can take a photo of all of you together. The rest of you may also do so as well. Thank you for being with us tonight. Go Friars!